Good morning, church family.
Good morning.
Take it down a notch. All right, that's better. Thank you all for many of your calls and texts regarding the passing away of my mother. It was very unexpected. And kind of a shock for all of us, but I thank you for your concern. I also want to welcome all of you that are worshiping with us for your first time today, and we pray God's blessing on you as you worship with us. I do want to bring up a couple of announcements. Today at 3 o'clock is the Christmas shoebox packing party at 3 o'clock back in the fellowship hall. We're going to need all the help we can get. But I hope that y'all understand, depending on what happens, I'm going to go see about my dad this afternoon. Depending on what happens there, I may or may not make it. I hope y'all understand. My father is going through, he's had strokes, he's had heart attacks, he has had lots of things happen in his life that I have never seen him so torn up. And I'm very concerned about him. So we're probably going to spend some time with him again this afternoon. But I hope you'll notice all of the announcements in the bulletin and keep yourself aware of all that's going on in our church. Let's begin our worship service with prayer. Father God, as I look out over this congregation, it is so good to see so many in here today. Some that come here a lot, some that may be visiting, some that perhaps come with family at times, but it is so good to see their faces as they gather here to praise you. And Father, I pray that everything that happens here today would bring glory and honor and praise to your blessed and holy name. For we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Methodist Church. Let us stand together and join in singing our song, our hymn of praise. I love to tell the story. Number 156.
Let us now share together as we affirm our faith, this beautiful creed of the Christian faith, the Nicene Creed. Will you join me? We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God,
eternally begotten of the Father,
God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and Son is to be worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Join together again in singing The Old Rugged Cross, hymn number 504. Time for our children to come forward for their special children's time. Then you're welcome to go to children's church. Good. Good morning, Michael and Nora, Brielle. How's that baby sister been? Okay, good. I bet she's keeping you up at night.
No.
Really?
Okay.
She does.
Oh,
that's precious.
Nora and you sleep in our own room upstairs.
Mm-hmm. So we don't wake from that crying.
Good morning.
Good.
How is everyone? Okay.
Everybody stayed shy today.
Okay. Today I want to talk to y'all about Jesus Christ. But first, I want to ask if any of y'all have best friends.
Yeah.
Aubrey Freeman.
Karsten.
Okay, now that we know everyone's best friends, my best friend is Jesus Christ. So, he is my best friend because, you know, I can talk to him about anything and everything. He always listens, and he'll help you with whatever you're going through. Do you ever ask Jesus for help when you're in need?
No.
I do, and you should. 'Cause God is here to strengthen our friendships, and you can spend time in prayer with him, read the Bible, and attend church. And these actions will help you grow closer to God and deepen your friendship with him. And I have a Bible verse, Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through him who gives me strength. This verse encourages me and reminds me of the strength I can find in Jesus. Pastor D, can you come pray for us?
First of all, Miss Jacqueline, stand up a second. One of our babies is now teaching children's church. I'm so proud of you. Father God, we thank you for what church family means, how as we teach each other and new generations come along, they come along to teach another generation. Father, that's the way it's supposed to be, and we thank you so much for seeing that happening in this church. In Jesus' name, amen. That was awesome. I remember when I came here 8 years ago, when your girls were just babies.
I know, it's really good.
It's really awesome. By the way, before we go to prayer, I think you had one that had a birthday this week, didn't you?
I've got one.
And then somebody else is having a birthday,
right?
Right?
Yes, we sure do.
You want to acknowledge their birthday, your two birthday girls?
I've got my mother here today and my daughter, Juliana, the oldest one, and she had a birthday, and so did my mother. They are just a few days apart, and then my brother, they're here from North Carolina with his family, and we're just very happy to be here with my church family.
Juliana hit the big 21 this week.
Yes.
And her grandmother is still claiming that.
Thank you, Pastor.
Let's pray together. Father God, we are thankful for the strength you give each and every one of us every day. For some days, Lord, when we get up, there's lots of joy and we're ready to go. And some days when we get up, we're having a tough time. Father, I am so thankful for the strength you give us to make it through each and every day. For Lord, I know there's people in this room that rely on that strength. And we give you thanks for it. Father, we ask, oh God, that you would forgive us when we doubt that strength and when we try to rely on our own strength to get through things. For Lord, on our own, we are nothing. But with the God of the universe on our side, we join Paul who says, if God is with us, who can be against us? And for that, we praise your name. Lord, this morning we continue, as always, every Sunday to pray for our nation. Lord, I pray for those individuals that would stoop so low as to try to make fun of the Lord's Supper as part of the Olympics. presentation the other night. Father, it makes us angry in some ways for how dare they make fun of the living God. And yet, Lord, it just reminds us that we need to pray for those people because they don't know anything about you. If they did, they would dare not do that. And so, Father, I just pray that you would convict and convince them of the truth of your word. Father, I personally want to thank you for helping me through this morning and through the other night when my mom passed away. And Lord, I want to lift up my dad. Father, he just needs encouragement. He needs strength right now. And I pray that people from this church and from his church and others would just give him words of encouragement and strength and let him know that he is loved. For Lord, you know as well as I do, I've never seen him like this. And so give him, help him be reminded that there is still purpose in his life until that day you call him home. It's the same for all of us. We have purpose to serve you. Father, this morning, though, we also take time, as is our custom, to lift up people that are on our hearts this morning. And so, Father, hear the prayer concerns of my brothers and sisters. Any others? Lord Jesus, I also want to thank you for the love this congregation has shown me this week. And Father, for a dear brother, Brother Eddie Gooch, who took time away from his home church with his family to be here today. And Lord, it just reminds me so many times of how you place people in my life that when I go through difficult times, they are there for me. And for that, I give you praise. And we make our prayer in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us worship the Lord now by the giving of our tithes and offerings. Thank you.
tithes and offerings are pleasing unto you, Lord. We thank you for giving us this house of worship that we so truly love to share with others, Lord, and to share the love of Jesus and bring them here to your house, Lord. We ask that you continue to pour out your blessings upon this church so that we can further your kingdom. In your sweet name I pray. Amen.
Join me in prayer. Almighty God, hidden in you are all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Open our eyes that we may see the wonders of your word, and give us grace that we may clearly understand and freely choose the way of your wisdom. Through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. We've been talking about relationships based on 1 Corinthians 13, this will be our third week, and we'll be wrapping it up today. Today I want us to be thinking about, also to start this out, how the world sees relationships. Relationships are disposable in the worldliness. And I've got two little songs that were pretty famous at one time. One came out in 1979. That guy named Rupert Holmes sang this song. And if you will now play that for us, sir, you'll have to just go by my slide guide, not that big thing.
I was tired of my lady. We'd been together too long. Like a worn out recording of a favorite song. So while she lay there sleeping, I read the paper in bed. And in the personal columns, there was this letter I read. If you like piña colada,
we know the how the rest of us that song goes. Now, one thing I never understood, you went backwards. One thing I never understood is he reads this article in the paper, and this lady that is wanting to meet somebody, and they work out a plan. He puts something in the paper and says, I agree with you, let's meet at so-and-so place. What I never understood, though, is how he knew it was going to be this lady he'd never met before. But the problem was, he and his lady, hopefully they were married, but they had gone kind of tired of one another. The fire had gone out. The spark wasn't there. So he decides he wants to find a new lady. Well, he walks into that bar and it says, and then she walked into the place. I knew her smile in an instant. I knew the curve of her face. It was my own lovely lady. She said, oh, it's you. Now, in the song, they laugh about it. Truth of the matter is, in real world, they probably would have get pretty angry, wouldn't they? But the song teaches us a worldly view of relationships. And there's one more I need to share with you that came out even earlier than that. Years ago, Paul Simon told us that if we get tired of a relationship, here's what we need to do.
Just slip out the back, Jack. Make a new plan, Stan. You don't need to be coy, Roy. Just get yourself free. Hop on the bus, Gus. You don't need to discuss much. Just drop off the key. Make a new plan, Stan. You don't need to be coy, Roy. You just listen to me. Hop on the bus, Gus. You don't need to discuss much. Just drop off the key, Lee, and get yourself free.
So, as I said, just slip the out. World sees the relationships as disposable, because they base relationships on emotions, feelings, and desire. But those are not godly relationships. Amen. We're talking about agape love. You know, our world teaches that even if you don't even want to really leave your person, that it is still okay if your relationship's kind of cooled off to develop a friendship, if you know what I mean, on the side. But let's compare that to what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 13:7. Love bears all things, believes all things, and hopes all things. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks
Thanks be to God. We've been talking about the last few weeks about this agape love of God and how it affects relationships. Over the last 2 weeks, just to do a little reminder for some of you that you weren't here, that we said this kind of love reminds us that we shouldn't have a short fuse because love is patient. We ought to cover each other with kindness because love is kind. We ought to practice humility because love is not puffed up. We shouldn't envy one another because love does not envy. We need to learn to make a deal. In other words, we should compromise because love does not demand its own way. And that we should not dig up the past because love does not keep records of wrong. So all of these are traits of agape love that will come into our hearts and will grow in us if we let God's Holy Spirit work in our lives. And He will help us to improve or to protect or to preserve or to repair relationships. So, now I want to tell you this. I gave you a sermon outline on the back, but I'm not going to be following that exactly. I had quarter written the outline and had it in order the way I thought until my mama died. And I got down here early the next morning before my daughter and grandson were going to be coming in. And I felt led to rearrange it so that the first one I want to be reminded of is that if we want to properly help our relationships, we need to hang on for the long haul. Paul says, love endures all things. We are too quick in the United States of America to give up on relationships. When there's disagreements, people run for divorce lawyers. When a man and woman say, I do, and they say, from this day forward, I will hold you for better or for worse, for richer or poorer, sickness and health. But sadly, what's happening is many people that even get married in a church, as soon as life gets poor or there are health issues, one of them begins to want to bail out. That's what these two songs that I just kind of wanted to start the sermon in a different way reminds us, that when things get tough, just leave. Now, I do want to say this. I do not want to be recorded as a preacher that says there should never, ever be a divorce. Because if there's abuse, a possible physical harm, never let it be said that I don't believe there are times for that divorce has to take place. But mostly what we're talking about is people that when they hit a tough spot, they hit a rocky patch, they won't stick with it anymore. They're kind of like, well, I don't love him or anymore, because they base love on feeling or passion. But love is a commitment. Even when things might not be so great. My mom and dad, there they are. That's my dad when he's probably then the age I am now. My mother was 2 years younger. They met when she was 15 and he was 17. They dated for 5 years. And then they got married, and let's see, I'm about to turn 65, so were married 67 years. Now, there was times, I'm quite certain, because I know we doubty men, that my mother probably wanted to throw in the towel. And I'm sure there sometimes my dad felt the same way. But one of the things that my dad is really struggling with guilt right now, some things he may have said, you know, when something like that happens, you think about, well, why did I say that or why should I say that? But my brother brought up something that he told him and I told him to try to help him. The last 10 years or so of my mother's life has not been good. She could hardly get around very well on a walker, but she had a digestive issue that caused such problems that it made it extremely difficult for them to ever leave home. He could have put her in a nursing home and enjoyed his life. But she said she never wanted to go in a nursing home. Even when this most recent bout happened and it looked like that might have been the way to go, he said, no way. I promised her I'd never put her in a nursing home. That's what I'm talking about, commitment, folks. See, people need each other. They need people they can count on. And folks, I know that love can be transformative. When we stick by people we love, even when they make mistakes, we never know how God might use us to change people that we love. And when I got to thinking about this, I'm reminded about how God is in it for the long haul with us. How do I know that? There's a great illustration between God and humanity that really happened in the book of Hosea that I've mentioned before. God tells Hosea to go out and marry a woman named Gomer. Gomer was a very promiscuous woman. He ends up having three children with her, but her promiscuity returns, and it gets so bad that she sells herself into slavery. And Hosea has to go and pay a price of redemption to bring her out of slavery. Sound like a similar story, doesn't it? For we sold ourselves into death and to sin by returning against God. And God paid a high price for our redemption because He is faithful. God does not throw in the towel on us because our God is faithful. He never gives up on us, for He sees the possibilities of who we might be in Him. He encourages us to become that. He forgives our mistakes, and His love never gives up. For Paul says in Romans 8:38, nothing can separate us from God's love, neither death nor life, nor angels or demons, nor fears for today or worries for tomorrow. Not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above, the earth below, indeed nothing at all will be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. So, first of all, hang on for the long haul. Second of all, though, don't be a speck inspector. In other words, don't sweat the small stuff. Paul says, love bears all things. Folks, when you love somebody, you're going to have to put up with some of their quirks. And don't constantly bring up the wrong thing. So what if the towel's not folded right? So what if the bed isn't made exactly perfect? What does it matter in the big scheme of things? But what we tend to do after years of relationship is we begin to be a speck inspector. And what did Jesus say about that? He said, why worry about the speck? And He says your friend's eye, but you could even say your spouse's eye or your child's eye or your parents' eye when you have a log in your own. We're too quick to notice the faults of other people and never notice our own faults. You know, when a person is new in a relationship, everything is perfect. You see them with rose-colored glasses. It just like everything's going great. But one day those rose-colored glasses come off. And you begin to notice those things. Things that are not you're too wild about. And you begin to point those out. And before you know it, you're pointing out a lot of faults all the time. And so, in trying to get them to change to suit what you want, you point out their faults. But the problem with that is sometimes, if you point out too many faults, the other person can get very stubborn and resistant, and battle lines can be drawn, or they can begin to feel like they can never do anything right, so why even try anymore? I had a friend in seminary that he got married, and he said, you know, first little bit was great, but now I've learned that I live in files, F-I-L-E-S, meaning things are correct and orderly, and she lives in piles. So they had to make a deal that I talked about last week and learned to compromise on that. Folks, a person who is a spectator makes the other person feel on edge. And as I said, never do anything right. But folks, I'm not just talking about husband and wife. I can also talk about children and parents. Sometimes parents, because they want their kids to excel, what they'll do is they always tell them, well, okay, you did good, you made a B, but you should have made an A. Well, what does the Bible say about that? It says, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up into training and instruction of the Lord. Folks, negativity can be toxic to relationships. And if you don't want a relationship anymore, just be negative all the time. But the third thing that Paul mentions that I believe he's telling us we should accentuate the positives. He says, love believes all things. He believes in the better part of things. For example, a farmer working out in the field, they can go and do everything, cultivate the soil, plant the seed, water it, but he does all that so that something will come out of it, right? Well, if we want a relationship to work, we have to cultivate it by being positive about the relationship, encouraging the person we love to let them see the love by encouragement. Paul is telling us agape love always looks out for what's the best in the other person, not the worst. It doesn't see a lump of gold. It sees a diamond in the rough. And I think we manifest this kind of love in a way that helps us to move from expectations to encouragement. It allows us to help the other person to do better without feeling threatened. But you know what happens in some relationships like husband and wife? Say, for example, the husband's already got a job doing well, but the wife decides the kids have grown up and she's decided she wants to go to school, get a degree, and get a job. Well, sometimes some husbands will discourage that because they don't want change in their relationship. Well, what does that do? It makes her feel resentment. Instead, the husband should encourage. Say, yeah, go for it. When she gets her job, yeah, great for you. Because Paul says, encourage one another, build up one another, encourage the faint heart, help the weak, and be patient with everyone. So if you want to preserve a relationship, don't point out faults all the time. Sometimes you have to, but mix some encouragement in there. And finally, hold out hope. Paul says, love hopes all things, or some versions say, love never loses hope. You know, Jesus always held out hope for other people. If he saw other people that the religious leaders saw unworthy of love, unreachable by grace, yet God, Jesus would show them the hope of God's love. Because that is the way God sees everyone, that we are worthy of being loved. God gave us a free will. We blew it. But he made a way. He held out hope through his son, Jesus Christ. And God hopes that we will all make the right choice and accept him as Lord and Savior. So he desires that. You ever thought about this? Since I don't believe God makes anybody do anything, that God hopes you will accept his son as Jesus Christ as Lord. Well, we ought to do the same thing in other relationships. If things are not going well, we ought to hold out hope that God can repair or preserve or say it. And folks, help us ask God to help us have the kind of view of the other person that He has of the other person. And folks, if God is granted you a relationship that everything's great, thanks be to God. But if you like most other human beings, you still have trouble every now and then in some relationships. Well, ask God to give you hope on that. If your relationship is rocky, ask God and have faith and hope that God will help change it. And if your relationship is so bad because of abuse or unfaithfulness, even though you may have to go your own way, you can still pray that God will redeem and change the other person. You see, our God is a God of hope. God is an expert in repairing and redeeming relationships. And I tell you the truth, I'm convinced the human relationships really can't make it without God being involved. So here's the way I want to end this sermon series. How is your relationship with other people? Are they filled with joy and closeness, or frustration and distance? And more importantly, even than that, how is your relationship with God? Let us pray. Father, we all have had time where relationships have not been good. But I truly believe that you can make a difference. And sometimes, God, you may allow circumstances to come along that seem so incredibly difficult, and yet you can use them to help something else. Father, it is my prayer for everybody in this room. No matter what relationships they have, if there's some that are problematic, that you would help them. Father, if there's someone here that needs to come and ask for help, help us to put aside our pride and lay it down at the altar. In Jesus' name, amen. Folks, there's something I wanted to share with you. It goes along with what I just prayed. Two things to show you how God works. My brother and sister and I aren't distant, but we had not been especially close. We saw each other, things there and the other, you know, from time to time. Well, over these past few months, with all that's been going on with my mother, we've talked a whole lot more. And this past Friday morning, or Thursday morning, before they took the medicine off of mother, and she was going to pass away. For the first time ever, and that I can ever remember, because I'm 10 years older than my sister, 3 years older than my brother, while my dad was in the room with my mother by himself, the three of us huddled up and prayed out loud together. And many of y'all know that for whatever reason, I have my oldest daughter just kind of cut us off. We never would hear from her. She found out my mom has died. And Buddy, last night, she blew my phone up with texts. Remembering my mother, telling me how much she loved my mother and my dad, and that she loved me, and that she come to realize she had gotten too consumed with all her own life and forgotten her family. Now, I pray that that will continue, but the point I'm trying to make is God can work out things if we trust Him. So again, the altar is open as we sing together. If you have anything regarding relationships or anything going on in your life you need to pray about, you're encouraged to come forward.
I just want to share with you that